even start. Quite a few years ago, someone made this comment to me, and I've never forgotten it. I've shared it publicly, that when they took part of the what they call the Lord's Supper, they said that was the most spiritual, uplifting time of their life. And I'm not going to deny that. But if you, because of the music, God's Word, thinking about the Lord, His death, all those things, if that's what you're meditating on. But if you took away the physical, could they still have that most spiritual, uplifting time of their life?
They better are their idolaters.
Right. And I thought as we read, as Bruce read there, that history from many years ago from Bumen. And I knew Bumen pretty well. Man, what those guys were, those were soldiers. Tough soldiers, and they pulled very few, they didn't pull...
Pull any punches.
And that we've actually turned some of our traditions into idolatry. And we certainly need to fight that. And we can. So as we go through some of our notes here, and of course this is going to be brief in an hour or less, or a little more maybe, and it's a very important subject. But let me read. I'm going to read quite a bit of this, but I have other thoughts too as we read. The Passover Supper was for the Jews only. And that, of course, never changes, and Scripture would also be for the church. And the first time we read about the Passover is in Exodus 12. And so I have a few passages out of Exodus 12 here. This is the ordinance of the Passover. There shall no stranger eat thereof, but every man's servant that is bought for money, when thou hast circumcised him, when he becomes a part of Israel, if he's a proselyte, then shall he eat thereof. A foreigner and a hired servant shall not eat thereof. It wasn't for everyone in the old scriptures. The Passover supper was a week-long celebration, including a full meal once a year. On the 14th day of Nisan, the Passover began, and for 7 days it existed. And on the 21st day, there was this major meal. It ended with that meal. It had quite a few rules and requirements. It never changes in Scripture to become a snack for the church whenever convenient. And I personally believe that's one of Satan's biggest hoaxes. That the Lord's Passover Supper for Israel became a snack for the church. And he's done pretty well. Exodus 12, in the same chapter a little earlier, in the first month, on the 14th day of the month, at even, in the evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 1 20th day of the month at even. 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses. For whosoever eateth that which is leavened, even that soul shall be cut off, killed. Capital punishment from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land. It wasn't a game. And earlier in the same chapter of Exodus 12, of course, they were to remember that they were slaves in Egypt, and they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. I understand there are some groups, I believe of Christian groups even, that try to follow God's word on when they take the Passover, and they do it once a year, and they keep it for a week, and they get rid of leaven in their houses, and they actually do that. So some endeavor to follow some of God's instruction on it. But number two, here's the big question. Did the Lord change the supper? And that is a major question in Christendom. And no, he did not. But did he give it some new meaning? Yes, he gave it some wonderful new meaning. The Passover supper got some beautiful, thrilling, exciting, wonderful new meaning. And for 1,500 years, Jews were keeping the Passover, remembering coming out of Egypt as slaves. But from that night forward, they had a forward look to a coming kingdom. And they were to remember the Lord Jesus Christ from that night forward. And that is a change, and that is beautiful. With Luke 22, Now the Feast of Unleavened Bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover. And verse 15, with desire, I desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. It is still called a feast, and it is still called the Passover, and it's still very, very Jewish. The Lord did not change the way or the rules of the supper, but he did change what the participant was to be meditating on. The Lord gave a forward look to the coming kingdom for the supper. And for 1,500 years, the Israelites looked back to the coming out of Egypt during the Passover. But here in Luke, he gives them a new look to the future. Luke 22:29, "And I appoint unto you, his Jewish disciples, a kingdom, as my Father hath appointed unto me, that you," not the church, but his Jewish disciples, "that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." That is in a number of places foretold about in the scriptures. Jeremiah tells us about that future look, that future, that forward look that was going to come. Jeremiah 23, verse 6 through 8. "Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that they shall no more say, The Lord liveth, which brought up the children out of Israel, out of the land of Egypt." The children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. That was, of course, the first Passover when they came out of the land of Egypt. "But the Lord liveth, which brought up and which led the seed of the house of Israel out of the north country and from all countries whither I've driven them, and they shall dwell in their own land." And that hasn't happened yet. And Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the Jews that would follow them are still looking for that time coming when they would have their own land. So that number two, did the Lord change? No, he didn't change the supper. It's still once a year, still a full meal, still everything that the law said it should contain, but he gave it new, wonderful, thrilling meaning. That look forward, they were to look forward to the kingdom coming, and they were to remember his death himself. Number three, the Lord also informs, let me see, I had a note here. I should mention this. There were seven key feasts or holidays on Israel's calendar. Three of those, it was mandatory to go up to Jerusalem three times a year. Now, that's quite something for, for thousands of years ago to travel that much, but that was on their calendar. Who decided to pick this one feast day to do to that Christendom would try to make a corruption of it and try to keep? Who decided that? Of the seven feast days that Israel had, why this one? Number three, the Lord also informs the disciples that from this night forward, when they keep the Passover, which was once a year, that they are to remember him and his great sacrifice along with that forward look, look to the kingdom. That kingdom, of course, is the Messianic, Davidic, Palestinian kingdom promised to the nation Israel. It included a Messiah that would come. It included Palestine, the land, and included the kings would reign, the Davidic reigns. Again, out of Luke 22, verse 16 through 20, "I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." His disciples would keep it another 30 or 32 years, according to their instructions here from the Lord Jesus Christ. But he wouldn't be there with them. "And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you," his Jewish disciples, "I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come." It's very interesting that the Lord Jesus Christ, this might be straining at something, you might say, but I don't think so. If the Lord Jesus Christ said, "I'm not going to eat this meal again until the kingdom comes," and if we should practice our endeavor of the Lord's Supper, would the Lord be here? He said, "I won't be here. I won't eat this with you again until the kingdom comes." I believe you have to do it without the Lord if you do it. But let me read again here from God's Word. For I say unto you, his Jewish disciples, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, This is my body which is given for you. This do, this Passover, do in remembrance of me. And that is a change. No longer are you remembering coming out of Egypt, but now you're to remember me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant or New Testament. Those two words actually are synonyms, but it's not talking about the New Testament that we call the book of the Bible from Matthew to Revelation. When the Bible talks about the New Testament or New Covenant, it's talking about a promise made with Israel that's going to be in the future yet. We do call, quote, Matthew to Revelation the New Testament, but that's the name we've given it. But the New Testament or New Covenant in the Scriptures is going to be made with the nation of Israel. That last line of verse in round 20 again, likewise also the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the New Testament or covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Of course, the New Covenant or Testament is not for the church. The church will... The new covenant will be made with the same people that had the old covenant, the nation of Israel. The church is not part of the new covenant. Jeremiah 31:31 and Hebrews 8:8. I hope we can all quote that or know that by heart. And I believe most of Christendom knows that verse. I've often thought of this. They know the verse. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Most Bible preachers, most priests probably, know that passage. How many of them believe it's for the church? Most. Number four. The Apostle Paul reminds the Jewish Christians at Corinth of what took place the night the Lord was arrested, and rebukes them for their corruption of the Passover. You know, if you're reading in, it's a transition book, the book of Corinthians, written around Acts 18, 1 Corinthians. And in chapter 10, he recognizes the Gentile, the Jewish Christians there. He says, you know how all our fathers were under the cloud in the sea and all passed through the sea. And he's talking to Jewish Christians. In chapter 12, he talks to some of the Gentile Christians there. It's amazing during that transitional time period, how, and as you read those transitional books, how there's Jews being dealt with and Gentiles being dealt with. And in chapter 12, he says, now I speak unto you Gentiles when it comes to gifts. You all know that you were Gentiles in chapter 12. And so sometimes we can actually read where he's identifying his audience in 1 Corinthians. But in 1 Corinthians 11, when you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. I'll challenge you to look that up in maybe 30 different translations and to study that one passage. Christendom doesn't really know what to do with that passage. Some translations say you cannot eat the Lord's Supper. You should not be eating the Lord's Supper. You cannot eat the Lord's Supper. It's amazing. And they're not really sure exactly what that verse is saying. When you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. Why? The Lord's Passover Supper was to be eaten at home and at night. It wasn't a communal thing. What? Have you not houses to eat in? Or despise ye the church and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. And later, of course, in the same context, and he says, The Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do, this Passover, you're to do in remembrance of me. He didn't change the Passover, he gave a different meaning. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament or covenant. The new covenant made with Israel, the new testament that's going to be made with Israel, in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often, and it's once a year, remember, and that never changes in the Bible. That as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. These are not our marching orders. We're to show forth his life and his resurrection, not his death, till he comes. This coming is for Israel to set up the kingdom. This coming is not for the church. We're looking for the Lord to come in the air to catch the church away. So the coming is not our coming at all. Wherefore, because of these truths, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. It's still not a game. It wasn't a game in Exodus 12. It wasn't a game in Luke, in the Gospels, and it's not a game in Paul's epistles to the church. It's not to be taken lightly. Most of Christendom is guilty and eats unworthily. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Some actually die. There's a judgment that was taking place in 1 Corinthians. Not just in Exodus, where they were to be executed when they did something wrong with the supper, or in the Gospels, where the law is still in effect. But here, during this transitional time period, when God is still dealing with the nation of Israel, people died who took the supper wrong. If anyone goes to 1 Corinthians to say the church should have the supper, what about the people dying that are doing it wrong? This is extremely important. This next thought I have on here, I believe. Why do not people have people sick and dying today when they keep this feast unworthily? But Corinth sure did, because God was still dealing with Israel physically. The Christian Jews continued to practice the law, including the Passover, until the book of Hebrews was written. Four very distinctly Jewish things about brought out in the context here from the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians. It's the Jewish Passover taking place. The new covenant or testament, which is for Israel, is in view. This second coming is to the earth to set up the kingdom, not to catch the church away. And number four, kingdom powers are taking place. People are dying. None of that takes place today. In the passage that most people will go to say this is for the church out of 1 Corinthians, it's very Jewish. And the four key things that are extremely Jewish, and number one would be the judgment for people who are taking it wrongly. If you were going to study the supper, and we're going over briefly today, hopefully everyone will go back and read some of these passages, but if you were going to study the supper, you would start in Exodus 12, the first time you'd read about the Passover, and you'd read about it there. You'd go to the Gospels, and I quoted some out of Luke 22 here, which gives more information on the supper than any of the other Gospels. And you would go to 1 Corinthians 11, and you'd study those passages. I don't want to say something like, if you were honest, because I believe there's a lot of honest people that keep the supper. I'll mention this. When Dave Powers and Steve Whaley lived in Idaho, and they found a little fellowship, and they went to that fellowship, and they were apart. They were part of the fellowship. That fellowship took the Lord's Supper regularly, and Dave and Steve kind of, you know, didn't want to cause confusion there and didn't take part, but they were in fellowship there. When a Christian minister was going to come through that area, Dave and Steve asked the people at the church if they would have a Bible study with the Christian minister coming through on the subject. And they said, no way. We're not going to study that. That's a closed subject in their mind. And then Steve and Dave said, you know, we I don't think we have liberty to continue fellowshipping here if you're going to be closed. It was their God. It was so sacred you couldn't even study it. I personally have liberty to fellowship with any Christian I know if they're open. Isn't that kind of where you're at? It's not the subjects. You know, Christians don't... We might disagree on all kinds of subjects with whatever Christians you meet, but are we open? Are they open? I have liberty to go anywhere if there's an openness. If I could ask a question, if there's an openness. But when the openness is gone, then that stops my liberty. And I agree with Dave and Steve years ago saying if they're not even going to talk about it, you know, then we can't meet here. They could meet there with brethren who thought the supper was for today, and you know, they loved those brethren and it was a rich time. But when they wouldn't even talk about it, it became their God. Hopefully certain things don't become our God, that we can no longer talk about things because we're sectarian that way. 22, we look briefly, and we look very briefly in 1 Corinthians 11. But where else would you go? And you go to number 5 here. This is where Christendom goes. In desperation to hold on to the physical, often Christians read that they broke bread in the Scriptures and their minds have been programmed to go immediately to the supper. Many Protestants also just can't seem to be able to break away from Rome or human tradition. The following passages are often quoted to support the often and snack type supper that most of Christendom partakes of. Acts 2:42. I did have a Christian one time say, you know, if you take away the supper and water baptism and speaking in tongues, and we don't have anything left.
Bypass the Savior.
When you take away everything that's physical, it's what you got left that really counts.
Amen.
When you're facing the battle, when you're going into surgery, when you're dying, it's not the physical. It's what. When you've taken away everything that's physical, it's what you got left that's really worth dying for.
Amen. Can't be taken away.
And it can't be taken away. I cannot take Jesus Christ away from you, or the Holy Spirit, or salvation, or fellowship even, or faith, or the abundant life, the living word. Breaking of bread. Acts 2:42, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and the fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers, and breaking bread from house to house, they did eat their meat with gladness. The disciples often ate together, but it wasn't the Passover. I have been quoted these verses as saying that, you know, this is the Lord's Supper. They simply shared meals together. Acts 20:7-11. And upon the first day of the week, which happens to be sundown Saturday evening, upon the first day of the week, Saturday evening, when the disciples came together to break bread, and that's not the Passover, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, but continued his speech until midnight. And as Paul was long preaching, he started in the evening at sundown, and he preached all evening. Eutychus sank down with sleep, fell down from the third loft, and then that caused quite a disturbance. And the scripture says, trouble not yourself, for his life is in him. When he therefore was come up again, he had broken bread. And of course, that's not the Passover again. It's just they ate a little bit more again. And eaten and talked a long while until break of day, so he departed. Most of Christendom actually believes that this meeting mentioned here is what informs the church that we should have the Lord's Supper on Sunday morning. That's the passage they go to believe that, most do anyway, that it's Sunday morning when that's the time. By the way, in 2 Timothy, the scriptures thoroughly furnish us unto all good works. It will furnish us the time, the how, the where, the who. Well, if you read the scriptures then, it would be from the 14th day of Nisan to the 21st day of Nisan. It'll be a full meal, ending with a major meal at night. It'll be Jews only, or proselyte Jews. That never changes in scripture. So we have the when, and we have the who, and the how. And we'd be thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Most of Christendom actually believes that this meeting mentioned here is what informs the church that we should have the Lord's Supper on Sunday morning. They are in error. This meeting was Saturday evening. Sundown is the start of the next day in the Bible, and it was not the Passover or some newly instituted ritual called communion or the Lord's Supper or the Roman Catholic Mass. When I was a Methodist, we called it communion. 1 Corinthians, back to that same passage again, chapter 10. That's where he recognizes the Jews there, how all our fathers came through the cloud and were in the sea, verse 1 and 2. So all and all our fathers all ate the same spiritual meat. Even though the Jews kept a physical Passover and a physical meal, Paul sees a spiritual application even for them. They did all eat the same spiritual meat, and they did all drink the same spiritual drink. So even Israel ate and drank spiritually, and of course also physically. They drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. So now we're coming to the age-old battle. And Bruce, it's interesting you had that letter to read this morning, and I had these things that I thought I would go over. It's been a long time since I've gone over this. John 6, 52 and 53. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? And of course, in that same passage, except eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Of course, those have been difficult passages. It was difficult for his disciples at the time. They struggled with it. A mixture of the Passover and Christ's death that Rome somehow uses to try to fulfill these verses. And I think a lot of Protestantism stumbles along with their own version of what they think is being taught, but both miss the context. When masses of men used to go off into the battles, especially like World War II, since then we do more technical fighting, but the Roman Catholic priest would bless masses of men, and they would give them a moon-shaped wafer, and they'd go off into battle trusting in the wrong thing. Who could have devised a system like that? I'd rather that priest had nothing there physical and just gave those men going off into battle something spiritual. If you accept Christ as your Savior, you'll have you drink His blood and eat His flesh and drink His blood, and you can do that spiritually by believing on Him, and you'll have life. And if you die in this battle, you'll go to heaven. How many people have gone into surgery or major events in their life trusting the physical? Hopefully, many of them went past the physical to the spiritual. And it is John 6:63, which was mentioned there in the letter that Bruce just read. It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Now go back and read the context. Except you drink my blood and eat my flesh, you have no life in you. And it troubled them. And what did they do? And the Lord cries out to them, the things that I'm saying is spiritual and it's life. The things that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life, not the physical. And I have the thought here in John 3 with Nicodemus. The Lord presents a new birth compared to a physical birth. And in John 4, the woman at the well, the Lord presents living water instead of running physical water. And in John 6, he presents spiritual truth, spiritual meat instead of physical meat. In John 3, the Lord teaches a spiritual birth in contrast to the physical birth. In John 4, it is a living water in contrast to physical water. In John 6, it is spiritual meat and drink in contrast to the physical. God wants our hearts and minds to be in the spiritual realm, not the physical. Even for Jews who kept a physical feast, the Lord wanted their mind on a spiritual plane. Even when the supper was properly done by Jews, the Lord wanted their mind on a spiritual plane, not just in the physical. Number 7. Israel had its authorized physical religion, but in the church, we are, Philippians 3:3, the circumcision, the cutoff ones, which worship God in spirit, rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Prison epistle. Real worship does not need physical elements. Back to 1 Corinthians, where the supper was still being practiced by Jewish Christians. Because, you know, at Acts 15, Gentile Christians stopped practicing any part of the law. There were 4 things they were told not to do that were offensive to Israel. But the Jewish Christians continued practicing rituals, holidays, the law itself, until Hebrews is written in Acts 28. 1 Corinthians 5, remember, Jews still practicing the supper here. For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. So even while a physical supper is taking place, Paul had a spiritual application for it. Therefore, let us, and that's probably written to the Jews and the Gentiles in that assembly, and the Jews were still practicing it physically, but let us keep the feast not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. How do we eat sincerity and truth? By keeping our feast, our fellowship, our communion in the spiritual realm and not the physical realm. By this shall all men know you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. It's a love that can be seen. And brethren, as we've forgotten that at times, we can ask God to forgive us, but a love that can be seen, and a communion that can be seen, and a fellowship that can be felt even in a spiritual realm. Colossians, again, another prison epistle. Let no man, therefore, judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of an holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days. There we have the ceremonial parts of the ceremonial law mentioned, and also the Ten Commandments mentioned, included in the same thought. Don't let anybody judge you in those areas. And how do we fulfill the above command? By not participating in Israel's physical religion, which, Hebrews 9:10, stood only in meats and drinks, and diverse or assorted baptisms, washings, and carnal, fleshly, physical ordinances imposed on Israel until the time of Reformation. And that wasn't 600 years ago under Martin Luther. It was 2,000 years ago under God in Acts 28, the time of Reformation. The law, including the Passover Supper, was imposed on Israel until the time of Reformation. Until Acts 28. But the church is free from that law. Christ fulfilled the law. Christ is the inner law for righteousness to everyone that believes, we're told in Romans 10. So number 8. 1 Corinthians 10. Remember, at this time, Jews are still practicing the Passover. Gentiles are not. This is written after Acts 15, when the Gentiles stopped practicing any Jewish law. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. The cup of blessing. Is that physical or is that spiritual language here? Even when Jewish believers were keeping a physical supper, Paul was trying to get them in their minds, at least on a spiritual plane. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion, the fellowship of the blood of Christ? Hopefully there's been times, hopefully today, we've experienced the communion of the brethren, the fellowship of God's people. The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For For we being many are one bread. Unity, communion. For we being many are one bread and one body. For we are all partakers of that one bread, Jews and Gentiles. And at that time, Jews were still practicing the supper. One way to observe this verse and to flee idolatry, which that's what it tells us to do here, brethren, dearly beloved, flee from idolatry, is to understand that we can't eat this bread because, as the passage teaches, we are the bread. And that is not forcing the scripture. We are the bread, it says. For we being many are one bread. The church is the bread. We're one loaf. Ephesians, another prison epistle. After the nation of Israel has been temporarily set aside. One of the verses, when I say prison epistles, I mean those verses by the Apostle Paul, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, Philemon, 1st and 2nd Timothy, written after God has temporarily set Israel on a shelf and aside. And in those books, you don't read Israel's religion at all. Of course, in the prison epistles, you won't find water baptism or speaking in tongues or the Passover supper or anything in that realm, because those are prison epistles and God is no longer dealing with Israel.
And an explanation of the prison epistles is where Paul was physically in Rome in prison.
He was physically in Rome and when he wrote those seven books. He wasn't in Rome in prison the entire time of those seven books, but that's the time period of those seven books.
Right.
Ephesians 1, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Today our blessings are spiritual in heavenly places, not physical and earthly places. Much of Israel's life was physical blessings in physical places. They also had spiritual blessings in spiritual places. It wasn't that they were held back spiritually, but they were a physical company of people. They had physical religion. They practiced, and they had physical blessings. But our blessings are basically spiritual. Whatever your relationship is with God's Word, with Jesus Christ, with God's people, the less you will need of the physical. When Jesus Christ is real to you and alive, and God's Word comes off the page at you and it is alive, and is thrilling, you won't need the physical. And like the people that have told me, and it's been more than one over the years, that their Passover supper was the most spiritual event in their life, I don't take that away from them, but it wasn't the physical. It was them thinking about the Lord. It was them reading God's Word. It was them thinking about Christ's death and the blood shed. And if you took the physical away, they could still have a spiritual communion with the Lord. And a feast. They could feast with the Lord. Colossians 2, a prison epistle again. Wherefore, if you be dead with Christ from the rudiments or elements of the world, why, as though living in the world, are you subject to ordinances? That's a great question for people that are complete in Christ, which are to perish with the using. Are you subject to ordinances? Question for myself and for you. If it is spiritual worship you practice, it will not perish with the using. I thought of this, and I've given it before, and it sounds very almost coarse. But when you're all done with your worship, is there a mess to clean up? Somebody's got to wash the cups. And when you're all done with your, which shall perish with the using. When we're all done with a spiritual feast, there's no mess to clean up. There's a lingering, wow. There's a walking toward your car with, my word, God, His word, the spiritual. You're no longer fighting for the physical. And the physical has caused confusion in Christendom for 2,000 years. Water baptism, the Passover Supper, all the various physical things of how to do it, who should do it, when to do it, who gets to do it. When it's on a spiritual plane, you want to be. It's on a spiritual plane that God wants you to be. Even when the law was in effect, even David, broken in a contrite heart, O Lord, thou wilt not despise. Even when the law said this is a sacrifice needed for his sin, David knew that that it was his spiritual attitude toward God that God wanted, not just a sacrifice, not just some physical sacrifice. Colossians 2:14, again, a prison epistle, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances. And verse 16, we just read how that included the Sabbath days and the ceremonial days. So it included the ceremonial part of the law and the Ten Commandments. Christ blotted that out. It was against us, nailing it to his cross. The law, including the Passover, was against us, but not anymore, thank God. We do not need physical elements to accomplish true worship today. If you find yourself in need of something physical, you are probably an idolater. If you just have to have the physical, you are an idolater. Because even when the physical was legitimate, it was the spiritual realm the Scriptures lead us to. And the cup of blessing which we bless, 1 Corinthians 10, is it not the body and blood of Christ? And yet there was a physical supper going on at that time. My next comment here, are you, I should say, am I guilty of mixing some Bible truth with Judaism, adding a little tradition of men and then some religious invention? Most are. Where we can say, God forgive us when we have violated God's word. So number 9. Again, John 24, Bruce was in that short letter you wrote and read. I thought when he read that, wow, he's taking my message from that old letter. John 4, the woman at the well. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. It's one of the musts in the Scripture. You must be born again. Well, if you're going to worship God, it must be in spirit and truth. And that's a small s, so that means your spirit. Your emotions, your feelings, your heart, and truth, of course, Scripture and facts. If you're going to worship God, it has to be with an attitude, your emotions, your spirit, of course, the Holy Spirit too. But this is not talking about the Holy Spirit. It's a small s here. It's talking about your emotions and feelings and the truth, God's word and facts. No wonder we have this prayer in Hebrews 8. Let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Because it's still not a game. It wasn't a game in Exodus 12 where they died. It wasn't a game in the Gospels where the law is still in effect. And it wasn't a game in 1 Corinthians where some died physically during 1 Corinthians time. How can most of Christendom put us back in that? When people died, millions of Christians, undoubtedly dear people, brethren, are keeping the supper and none of them are dying today. Do they know why? They sure died in 1 Corinthians 11. It was a Jewish holiday. And as they corrupt it today, God, this is a day of grace and we're not dying. We thank God for that. We thank God for that. After Hebrews 12:28 there, my next thought, we must worship God His way, or it is false worship. Our worship must be according to God's word. It must be the truth. It must be acceptable to Him. It must be with reverence and godly fear. And of course, thank God, we do have the grace, the enabling ability to do it. He allows us to do it. What a passage out of Galatians 3. Oh, foolish Galatians. Oh, foolish Christian. Who hath bewitched you? Who's put a spell on you that you should not obey the truth before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you? This only would I learn of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh or what the flesh can do? What a question for me! And where I failed the Lord, or where we've failed in what we've done, or have done, or can do. I'm grateful for grace. For where we failed, we have grace is available. Are you grateful?
Amen.
Grace.
Now raining.
It's now raining. We could be a company of Christians that didn't know this truth. The Lord would show us grace. We're raining. Wouldn't we be grateful? And there's different things we've been wrong at in the past, and we said, hey, we were wrong here, and we changed. It was grace. We did it ignorantly, like Paul could have said, he lived in all good conscience before God and man until this time. Well, he killed Christians, put them in prison, but he did it ignorantly, and God was gracious to him. God has been gracious to us. Aren't you grateful for that?
Amen.
For all the things we've ever done wrong, he's been gracious. And we are making a feeble effort to meet in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Christ promised that wherever two or three on this planet would do that, he'd be there. And I'm grateful that's true for all believers. Those questions out of Galatians 3 are so powerful. Oh, foolish Christians, Galatians. Who's put a spell on you that now you can be, that this is something in the physical realm that is now important? It's caused confusion. Rome has caused confusion with their supper. Protestantism has. When to do it, who should do it, how to do it, who gets to do it. Some groups have, you know, you can't take part in the supper because such and such, and they've hurt people's feelings over that. Every Christian in this room takes part in supper, takes part in communion. And there isn't anybody in this room that tells you you can't. It's available. Communion and fellowship. It is available to be fellowship with God. I might keep my fellowship away from you, but not. I can't keep God's fellowship away from you. And neither can anybody else. Crackers and grape juice will help me make me more perfect or make me perfect? Never. Galatians 3, for as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. Law keepers are under a curse.
Observers.
Law observers. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. James 2:10 tells us if we keep the whole law and are guilty in one point, we're guilty of the whole law. Guilty of all. Therefore, we come boldly to the throne of grace to help to find help in time of need because we're sinners. And we just trust everything on Him. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no man is justified or declared right by the law and all the parts of the law, which includes the Passover. In the sight of God it is evident, for the just shall live by faith, and the law is not of faith. The reason I say the Passover, because it's part of the feast days and the holidays and the Sabbath days. Colossians, we just read that. But the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. Okay, you're a new Christian, and you're reading God's Word. By the way, I was talking to Joe Weitzel yesterday, and he said that that his new son-in-law, Benjamin, Ben is going to be going over to Afghanistan for 9-10 months, and Leah is going to go back and live at home. But they're very happy. They've been very happy, and you can imagine a newlywed couple have to separate that way. But Joe said, he's so excited. He just saved a year or two ago, and he's so excited about reading God's Word. And he's just thrilled to read God's Word. And I said, that sounds great. And then I remembered back when I was first reading God's Word. And there came times when I was reading God's Word, and this is me, and it doesn't have to be you. It doesn't mean you might not have the same reaction that there's anything wrong. It's just that I would be reading and I'd come across a verse like that, that Christ shall be made a curse for me, and I almost can't even touch the Bible. This thing's alive. Jesus Christ is going to be a curse and made a curse. And when I read back in Psalms 22, I believe it is, where Jesus Christ said, I am a worm and no man. And that's prophetic. 1,000 years before Christ said it, it's prophetic of what Christ would say someday. I'm a worm and no man. And I almost can't even hold the Bible anymore. What do you mean? Jesus Christ is calling himself a worm, and that he's not even a man, and that he's going to be cursed. And if you can read that and just think that's just words, you got a real problem. He was made a curse for you. That touched me. It has touched me for 50 years now. That he was a worm because I am a worm. The only way I can read that with any logic is to say, wait a minute. Surely he's not saying, he's saying, well, I am. He's taking my place. He's saying, I'm a worm and I'm not even a man. And so the only way I can read that passage is to say, I'm the worm and I'm not the man. Because there's never lived a man like Jesus Christ, who was holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and never man spoke like him. And we owe everything to him. And he was the God-man. Second Corinthians 5 says, is a verse that says, he was made to be sin for us. Listen, if you can just pass that off, that Jesus Christ was made to be sin for you, and to think and not to think much of it, you got a problem. He was made to be sin for us, we're told. If you're invited to somebody's Lord's Supper, Passover Supper, that's graciousness on their part. I mean, they're not being rude or something. They're and being loving, and their heart could be right. But if they're trying to put you back under the law, it's false doctrine. It makes a difference what we believe. It makes a difference what we practice. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. In Hebrews 9, we're told, now once in the end of the world, he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Once in the end of the world, he came to appear to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Once. And we're told in a few verses later in Hebrews 9 also that Jesus Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many. The Mass calls it a daily sacrifice as they bring Christ down from on high. It's the most diabolical plot Satan has ever hatched, that they would crucify Christ over and over and over and over again. And Protestantism to go along with the corruption of that. Protestantism's Lord's Supper or Passover Supper is just a corruption of Islam. They don't want to go as far as Rome does and say what Rome does, but what does Protestantism do? They make a god out of it. Maybe I'll wind this down. We know some precious things. I'm sure there's a lot of things we don't know. There could be a lot of things a lot of other Christians could help us with. But what we do know, we do know. And we're accountable to what we know. On this subject, and like I mentioned earlier, I'm open on this subject. If someone wants to ask questions or challenge, we should never be afraid of that. It's God's Word. Excuse me? Yvonne says, the truth is such liberty. Let us keep the feast, we're told, by our apostles.
not with the old leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. We can be sincere and we can be truthful.